It's been one of the most significant and extraordinary years in American history.
I would not be surprised if we go up to 100,000 a day.
The country brought to a standstill by the coronavirus pandemic.
If you're not going to stay home and you're not going to wear masks in public, we have to enforce.
And massive demonstrations and unrest as protesters call for racial equality and police reform. Representative Karen Bass has been in the center of all of those fights. She joins us live to discuss these unprecedented times.
If we had a different administration, we would be having really aggressive, focused intervention.
The biggest issues of our time. An in-depth conversation with Representative Karen Bass. A Changing America. A Fox 11 Town Hall with your host, Elex Michaelson.
And tonight we welcome Congresswoman Karen Bass for an in-depth conversation on social reform, COVID-19, and the biggest issues of our time. Good evening and welcome to our live Fox 11 Town Hall at Changing America. I'm Elex Michaelson. A whole lot to talk about tonight. Congresswoman Bass joining us live from Capitol Hill, where she's still at work late at night. You're the chair of the Congressional Black Caucus. You just authored key legislation on police reform. You're working on legislation to deal with coronavirus. Oh, and you're also getting vetted as a potential vice presidential pick on the Biden ticket. So, as we like to say, you're having a moment. So, first question is, how are you sleeping these days?
I'm getting plenty of sleep because it's exhausting.
Yeah. All right. So before we get with the real questions, we want to remind everybody that we are taking viewer questions throughout the hour as well. Tag us on social media with the hashtag Fox11TownHall. Email your video questions to Fox11TownHall@FoxTV.com. Many of you already have, and we're excited to get to them. But let's start with the one question you least want to talk about, and that, of course, is the vice presidency. We know you're being vetted. You've told us before you would accept the job if you're asked. This week, a new commentary from one of the most senior columnists in California, George Skelton. We're putting it up on the screen. He says, in the LA Times, other papers, Bass's assets. Everyone likes her. She's comfortable to be around, is able to deal with Republicans. She doesn't make enemies. She's smart, energetic, and successful at achieving goals. She's calmly articulate, not bombastic, liberal, but not fiery. Most important for any VP selection, Bass wouldn't hurt the ticket. She'd probably help by adding a positive, reassuring force. Does he have a point? Is George Skelton right?
You know what? I'm so honored by what he said. I remember talking to him during those very difficult years in Sacramento, and so I was just very humbled and honored by his comments.
All right, so let me ask this question in a slightly different way, because I know you're not going to say that much about it. But on the issue of the vice presidency itself, this country was founded with the term, you know, all men are created equal. But what that really meant was property-owning white men. At the beginning of this country,
right,
blacks were considered three-fifths of a person. Women weren't even allowed to vote. What would it mean to you, or the little girl version of Karen Bass, the thought of having a black woman as vice president? And when you were a little kid, could you even imagine that possibility?
Absolutely not. You know, it would just be so meaningful. And I think about all of the little girls who grow up and who will never think twice about the possibility because it will be normal and natural to them. I will never forget the moment of where I was when Obama was declared the president of the United States. It was just a breathtaking moment. And it'll be the same thing when the vice president, when Biden chooses who his candidate is to be his running mate, whoever it is, it will be an incredible moment because it'll be a woman. We know that for sure. And then it would be especially exciting if it was an African-American woman.
And especially exciting if it was you, right? There's, of course, pictures of you and the vice president. Some would say that looks good together. All right, now let's talk about the big issue. There you are talking about the issue of health care with the former vice president. Coronavirus, the biggest issue in the country right now. The Senate holding a hearing on reopening in workplaces today. Dr. Anthony Fauci with a blunt warning for all U.S. citizens. Take a listen.
We can't just focus on those areas that are having the surge. It puts the entire country at risk. We are now having 40 plus thousand new cases a day. I would not be surprised if we go up to 100,000 a day if this does not turn around. And so I am very concerned.
So the question is, like, what happened here? Because at the beginning of this process, the U.S. and Europe were sort of on parallel tracks. Now Europe, it seems like, has gotten control over a lot of the coronavirus. The U.S. now has more deaths, more cases than anywhere else. Travel being banned to Europe. Here in California, states on the East Coast are banning Californians from going there. What went wrong, and who's to blame for this? And I know you're going to say a lot of this has to do with the Trump administration, but California is run entirely by Democrats, and we're having a huge spike.
But, you know, I mean, it just shows you how serious this is, because the leadership in California, in our state, our governor, our state legislature, and certainly our city and county, did everything they were supposed to do, but still, the virus has taken an incredible toll. Now, we would certainly be benefited if we got the appropriate help from the federal government, which was never coming. I remember at the beginning of the pandemic when Governor Newsom was having to hunt around the country for respirators, and where one state was being pitted against another. So I think we did what we were supposed to do. But I think it just shows you how serious the virus is, and we need the leadership. The other thing is that when the states all around us are not handling it appropriately, you know, people come and go. This is a major transportation center. And so I think all of that contributed to it.
You think we did what we're supposed to do when it comes to nursing homes, though? I mean, even the local officials here admit that that was a mistake, and we saw all the deaths in nursing homes in California.
Right. And I mean, you know, that was happening around the country. But, you know, we also had a number of our counties and cities that wanted to open up, people pressuring to open up. You know, I think that there were people and places in our state that contributed to it as well. And we are such a big state and people move around a lot. So I think it just goes to show you, when you do have the leadership, we still are in a very tough situation because this virus is so challenging. And so it's one thing to have a disease and it's spreading, but to have a disease that you really don't understand and you're trying to build the plane while flying it at the same time makes it extremely difficult. And I'm worried, too. Just think, we did what we were supposed to do. What about those states that didn't? You know, where Pence was the other day and he was sitting with his mask on in front of a choir. Now, you know those people in that choir are going to get sick. So you just wait in a couple of weeks when we see those states get really, really bad, where they didn't do what they were supposed to do.
So we got different questions on this. One of the questions that came into us was Dean Shermay. He works in food and beverage operations for the Edition Hotel in West Hollywood. And he sent us this question.
Is there any data that suggests that people going to bars and restaurants is what's causing spikes? And why should they continue to get punished when it's not illegal to go out and protest? So why should it be illegal to run your small business?
So what's your response to Dean?
Well, you know, there's a couple of differences. Number one, I wouldn't doubt that some of the protests contributed to it as well. But it is different when you're outside versus when you're inside. So you're in a bar, you're in a building. And so we definitely know that that is a big difference in terms of how the virus is spread and how it isn't spread. And so I think, I mean, we all have to play our part. Now, on the federal side, we have to get the HEROES Act passed, because pretty soon unemployment insurance is going to run out and people need another stimulus check. So I'm, you know, the part that I'm responsible for, we passed the bill out of the House, but I'm here in Washington and I'm responsible to do everything I can to push the Senate to get this bill up to the president's desk.
Yeah, because one of the points that Dean was making, we didn't play this part of the question, is what are you guys going to do to help all the people that are now out of work because of the government's decision? So what is the status of that? Where are we actually at in terms of getting more legislation? The president suggesting maybe we should send another check to Americans. Is that actually going to happen?
Well, yeah, that check is in the HEROES Act. It's sitting over there in the Senate. When we passed it out of the House, it is sitting there, ready to be passed. All the Senate needs to do is take it up. And I'll tell you what I really think is going to happen. You know, the unemployment runs out at the end of the month. And I hate to say this, I really do, for all of the people that are suffering. But what tends to happen in the legislative world is that we wait until the last minute. And that's when the pressure builds. So for all the people watching the show, and for that young man that had his concern about the bars and the restaurants, make a phone call to Mitch McConnell. because they could take that bill up tomorrow. They really could.
Well, let's talk also about the health aspect of this. Some folks may not know that you used to be a physician's assistant before you were a member of Congress. We got a question from civil rights attorney Areva Martin, somebody you know well, a frequent guest on our political show, The Issue Is. She sent us a question about racial disparities when it comes to COVID. Here's her question.
Yeah.
Now that we're seeing the spike of cases all over the South and the Southwest, particularly here in California, can we expect this White House to develop a strategy to address African Americans, Latinos, and other communities of color that have been hit hard by coronavirus?
Can we?
Well, you know what? I'm sorry to say the answer right now is no. But I will tell you we've been trying, and let me tell you specifically what we have done. We, when we passed the last bill, the CARES Act, we put in there an order for the Center for Disease Control to give us the data. It's really hard to address the problem if you don't exactly know where it is and how bad it is. So the only information we have right now is pretty much anecdotal in terms of where the disproportionate rates are. What I believe needs to happen is that we need to have a very specific intervention. And it's not just racial data. Just think about the people at the meatpacking plants who were forced to go to work. You need to do massive testing, massive contact tracing, and massive early intervention and treatment. You know, there's some good news in the LA area. Martin Luther King Hospital, Dr. Elaine Batchelor, who is the head physician there, she's been having quite a lot of success with African-American and Latino patients there by treating them early and being very, very aggressive. What I'm worried about is happening in a lot of our hospitals around the country is that African-American and Latino patients are going in and they're being sent home and they're told to quarantine in your home. Well, if you live with a lot of people, depending on what your circumstances are, you're not necessarily able to get the care that you need.
Right.
In Northern California, there's a disproportionate death rate of people who are Pacific Islanders. Hmm. In some states, it's Native Americans.
Let's ask one more question on this topic about your personal experience. When you were a physician's assistant, the AIDS outbreak happened, and you were on the front lines of that at a time when a lot of people didn't know very much about AIDS, and there were a lot of concerns. What were the most important lessons you learned being on the front lines then, which you now bring with you to the halls of Congress now?
Well, I will tell you, when COVID hit, it definitely gave me memories of AIDS. We didn't know what it was. They thought it was a pneumonia that gay men were getting, and they were dying. And I felt so bad because they would come into the emergency room and no one wanted to take care of them because we didn't know how the virus was spread. We didn't, in those days, we didn't even use gloves, like to draw blood and to do, you know, certain procedures we did, of course, but many we didn't. So we didn't even know how to protect ourselves. And I think the most important lesson I learned is that you have to treat people with empathy. You have to take care of them no matter what, and you can't shun them. I mean, it was really bad, some of the things that happened in the early years of the virus.
Yeah. All right. Our conversation continues after this break. Coming up next, we're going to talk about those protests, the recent Black Lives Matter protests, and the Congresswoman's push for police reform in Congress. A status update there. Must continue to answer your questions. Tag us on social media with the hashtag Fox11TownHall. Email your questions to Fox11TownHall@FoxTV.com. We'll be right back. Here's a question that you can see up on your screen. With so much division in our country, do you think we will ever see our future unity and healing towards each other as Americans? We'll talk about that when we come back.
You're watching A Changing America, a Fox 11 Town Hall with your host, Elex Michaelson.
After millions took the streets to protest the death of George Floyd, what comes next? What's the status of police reform? Welcome back to our Fox 11 Town Hall of Changing America. Joining us live from Washington, Congresswoman Karen Bass, who wrote the House's police reform legislation. We got lots of questions on that, including this one from Natalia. She's an 11-year-old viewer from L.A. After her father actually died in gun violence, she became a young activist. Oh. She's a supporter of your bill. Here's her question about police reform.
Hello, Representative Karen Bass. My name is Natalie Jackson. Now, it is very clear and obvious that there is an issue in American policing. What can we do to combat racism from policing and the criminal justice system? Thank you.
She's a remarkable young woman. But to her point, we know that this bill has passed the House. This was your bill on Thursday. The Democrats stopped another bill going forward in the Senate that was Republican Tim Scott put forward. Where are we at? And are we actually going to see something happen? Because so often in politics, there's all this energy, all this movement, and then all of a sudden, you know, people focus on something else.
Exactly. And there's always the danger for that. But first of all, that's a very impressive young lady. And to ask such a powerful question, I want her to know that I hope she gets involved as a student. I hope she gets involved on her campus, maybe even running for student council, because you're never too young to get involved. But let me just say that the bill that was defeated in the Senate mimicked a lot of parts of our bill, but it didn't have the enforcement. It didn't have the teeth. And what I feel very passionately is with the hundreds of thousands of people who have been protesting in every state in the country, in many countries around the world, this is not the time for us to do police reform light. This is the time for transformative change. So it is part of the process, as they say here in Washington. It's how the sausage is made. It's what happens behind the scenes. So we passed our bill. We sent it over to the Senate. They had their bill. Their bill failed. What we're going to do in the meantime is try to bring as much pressure as possible on the Senate to take up our bill. Now, in the meantime, we're all talking. A number of my Republican colleagues came up to me throughout the debate and talked about how they liked different parts of the bill, but they couldn't quite get there to vote for it. But you know what? We did get Republican votes. We had three Republicans to vote. That's no small matter, because the president tweeted. And typically what happens is if the president tweets and instructs the Republicans to vote or not vote, lockstep 100%, that's what they do. So the fact that three of them peeled off, the fact that all of the Democrats voted for the bill, and that's no small matter either, because before George Floyd, you would have not had 100% of the Democrats voting for a bill like this. What it indicates is a seismic shift in our country in terms of people's consciousness around policing. Before, when there was a murder, even if there was a murder on videotape, you would do polling, and polls would say, black people think this way, white people think this way. And it was a polar opposite. What has happened now is 70% of white America believes there is a fundamental structural problem with policing in America. And in my life, I've been involved in this issue for decades. This is the first time I have ever seen that happen.
And you've been working on this for 47 years. You were at the George Floyd Memorial.
47 years.
You talked with the George family and told them that you were going to get this done. So what is the red line for you in the negotiation, the thing that you and Democrats absolutely have to have in that bill in order to pass it?
You know, to say it in general terms, it would be enforcement. So in other words, I don't want to do legislation where there's no way to know whether you've had a difference. So there's a lot of different pieces to it. But if you ask me for what's the common thread, is enforcement, making sure that something sticks. Otherwise, it's window dressing. Now, I want you to know that I'm talking to my Republican colleagues. I was over talking to Senator Scott today. And sometimes after you go through the process of doing the bill, voting for the bill, then you begin talking. So I don't say that nothing is going to happen. I'm still very hopeful that we're going to get a bill on the president's desk. And if we have enough Republican support, the president will sign it. He'll take credit for it.
We'll talk a lot more about police reform later in the show with Congresswoman Bass. Also coming up next, we're going to have more of your viewer questions, including one important to all parents who have kids in schools. Keep sending us your questions. Tag us on social media, the hashtag Fox11TownHall. Email your questions to Fox11TownHall@FoxTV.com. We'll be right back.
You're watching A Changing America, a Fox 11 Town Hall with your host, Elex Michaelson.
How can we work together to bring more music and arts education to California's public schools? Music and arts education are essential for children's social and emotional well-being, whether through distance learning or in person.
Welcome back to our town hall with Congresswoman Karen Bass. So what do you have to say about what Valerie just said?
Well, I would add to it, one area that music is extremely important for that she didn't mention is academic achievement, because it's been proven many times over that if you have musical training, it certainly helps you with math skills. So I think that we should do so much more in terms of education funding. I think, again, we're lucky in California because before COVID, our economy was very strong and we had a really large surplus. But we have to work on the federal level, too, and make sure the schools have the resources they need. When the schools cut back, what's the first thing that goes? Arts, art and music. And I think that's a shame. We want our students to be very well-rounded and to have a world-class education.
And it's more complicated in this era of distance learning as well, in some of those
really
aspects
is.
As well.
I'm really... You know, there's so many ways that we're going to be dealing with the side effects, the ramifications of COVID. Students who've been out of school for months, and especially young kids, you know, you make a big assumption about parental computer skills. So I'm very worried about our achievement sinking to even lower levels because of COVID.
All right, let's go back to the whole VP issue. Now that you're being considered for VP, journalists are going through everything you've ever said in your entire life. And there is there's one comment that's especially controversial. It came after the death of former Cuban dictator Fidel Castro, who we know most Cubans in Florida, which you need to win potentially, not big fans of.
Absolutely.
You said this. Yeah. This was the comment you made about the passing of Fidel Castro. You said, quote, "The passing of the comandante en jefe is a great loss to the people of Cuba." That's translated to commander in chief. So Michael Knowles, who is a well-known conservative commentator and frequent guest on our political show, The Issue Is, he hosts the Michael Knowles Show on Daily Wire. He sent us this question.
Representative Bass, you've supported and worked closely with Black Lives Matter, an organization whose leadership has described itself as, quote, trained Marxists seeking to, quote, dismantle the Western prescribed nuclear family, and who have posed smiling in photos with the communist dictator of Venezuela. You yourself have praised Cuban communist dictator Fidel Castro. Are you willing to disavow Marxism and communism? And if so, assuming that you are, why do you continue to support self-described Marxists? Thanks.
Your response.
Well, you know, that's very interesting because I've known Black Lives Matter individuals for quite a while, and I have never known of Black Lives Matter to be a Marxist organization. You know, one of the challenges with organizing today that's very different when I was coming up is that we did have more solid organizations, whereas now you can have people who are affiliated with a lot of different groups. So that's a Black Lives Matter chapter that I'm surely not aware of.
But what about the Cuba question and this idea that that it was a great loss when Fidel Castro died?
Yeah. Well, you know, I think that, first of all, the last thing I meant to do was offend anyone. And what I did do is exactly what you said. I used the Spanish translation for commander in chief. Fidel Castro was the prime minister and commander in chief. And I most certainly did not mean to offend anyone. But, you know, I have worked for diplomatic relations and relations between our countries for a long time. In fact, I traveled to Cuba with John Kerry when we raised the flag and replaced the flag. And I also had the incredible honor of traveling to Cuba with President Obama. Cuba is 90 miles away from our country. And I believe that it's very important for us to have relations with all of our neighbors. You know, in Congress, I focus on Africa and 54 countries in Africa, a lot of different governments. And even when we disagree with the government, and there's a lot of things I disagree with, even when we disagree, I think it's important to have diplomatic relations. And I think we are far more powerful when we engage in countries. If we just cut them off, then we give them an excuse, frankly, to do whatever they want to do.
So if you
I
had
have
that to,
always promoted engagement.
So if you had that to if you had to do that over again, you would say it the same way?
If I had to do it over again, I probably would have deleted that if it offended people. But again, promoting the relations between our two countries, I would never do that over again.
All right, coming up on our Fox 11 Town Hall, much more with Congresswoman Bass, including more on race relations, a look back at her long history in this city. Still time for your questions, too. Tag us on social media with the hashtag Fox11TownHall. Email your questions, Fox11TownHall@foxtv.com. And here's a question that is coming in to us. Why is it okay to protest outside and it won't have an effect on the illness, but they're closing the beaches? What's the difference? A lot of people wondering about that. We'll maybe bring that up when we come back.
You're watching A Changing America, a Fox 11 Town Hall with your host, Elex Michaelson.
The bill is passed.
One of the architects of that House police reform bill is Congresswoman Karen Bass. Welcome back to A Changing America, our Fox 11 Town Hall with Congresswoman Karen Bass, who joins us live from Washington. So we've got a viewer named Marco Ramirez, another young man, who is asking about police reform.
Okay. Hi, Karen Bass. I just want to start off by congratulating you on the passing of the Justice in Policing Act, which is a true game changer for America. My question is, if you were to become Vice President of the United States of America, what further changes would you make to our policing system to add on to the great progress that you've already made?
Yeah, because there's only so much you can do right now with the president in charge and Republicans in charge. If Democrats actually took over, specifically if you took over, what more would you do?
Well, I think especially the part of the bill where we're talking about accreditation and training, I would really want to delve into that and make sure that that training is robust, make sure that the accreditation and the standards, you know, it's one thing to pass a bill, but then you really have to get it enforced and implemented. And that's always a gap. So I never believe in just working on passing. I also believe in the implementation as well.
Now to this question about the police. John Cobalt, half of the John and Ken show on KFI AM 640, I'm sure it's your favorite show, he wanted to ask you this about the LAPD.
The Los Angeles Times says the LAPD opened fire on 26 suspects last year, a five-year low, and that number is down 77% since 1990. 22 of the 26 were armed with a gun or knife. Based on those numbers, do you think that the LAPD has made significant progress in the last 30 years?
Your thoughts.
Well, I do think the LAPD has made progress in the last 30 years, but I think there's a lot more that needs to be done. But it's not all about policing. So you know that one of the real big problems the police department has is they're dealing with all of these other issues like mental illness and substance abuse. And I don't think that it is fair for them to have to deal with that. I know that a lot of the violent encounters are with people who have mental illness challenges. And I think that if we provided more health care, if we provided more facilities, you know that the Twin Towers, what they call that, the most expensive mental institution in the United States.
So what does that actually look like? Is that a mental health professional being paired with an LAPD person? Because what happens when a mental health professional goes into a situation that turns violent if they don't have protection?
No, it's about prevention. So, for example, when we deinstitutionalize people from the big facilities that we used to have, we did it with the understanding that we were going to build community-based institutions, and we never did that. What we did instead was we built jails and prisons. So it's about preventing that violent episode from ever happening. Of course, if it reached the level of violence, you know, a police officer has to respond. But one of the things we also have in our bill is programs to teach police officers how to de-escalate situations. And yes, they might be paired with the mental health profession, but primarily, it is prevention and treatment that is needed.
You know, one of the big questions also has been about this issue of police unions. LZ Granderson, who hosts a morning show on ESPN as a commentator on CNN, had this question on that issue.
Hi. My question is in regards to campaign contributions made by the police unions and whether or not you believe they are a helper when it comes to reforms or an obstacle. Thank you.
You know, I don't always think it's about the contributions. A lot of times people think it is. But, you know, for most campaigns, you have campaign limits. Now, there's other ways you can contribute that does have a lot more significance. But what I think is more important than that, though, is the way police unions and conservative organizations, because it's not always about the unions either, have been able to pass state laws that have passed police officer bill of rights and other pieces of legislation that basically have tied the hands of a lot of elected officials. Now, this isn't for us here, but in Minneapolis, for example, the police chief can fire somebody. The police officer can challenge it through arbitration and be put right back on the force. Mm. And so things like that that have happened across the country has made it far more difficult to deal with abusive officers and misconduct.
What do you make of the LA County District Attorney's race? We've seen Congressman Adam Schiff, Mayor Garcetti pulling back some of their support for Jackie Lacey. What do you make of that race?
Well, I think it's a controversial race. One of the things that's happening around the country is people are challenging sitting district attorneys because they're trying to get in people who are more progressive, who believe in reforms, who don't believe in relying on the criminal justice system to solve problems. One of the fundamental, in my opinion, conflicts of interest is district attorneys work very closely with police departments. They depend on them. They need them. And so then it becomes very hard for the district attorney to then file charges and prosecute police officers.
And of course, Jackie Lacey's biggest funder is police union. So who do you urge your people to support in that race?
Well, actually, I have stayed out of that race. It is the most high-profile district attorney race in the country.
Yeah. All right. We'll see if you jump into it at some point. Coming up, you know I love to play music. So we're playing some music from Ava DuVernay's film Selma. This song, Glory, by John Legend and Common, won an Oscar. It's about the struggle of John Lewis, one of Congresswoman Bass's mentors. We'll talk about him, talk about her story when we come back. But first, more music. Glory, glory. Oh.
Now the war is not over, victory isn't won, but we'll fight.
You're watching A Changing America, a Fox 11 town hall with your host, Elex Michaelson.
We got it going on at the Freedom School.
Back in 2018, we toured the Community Coalition in South LA with Congressmembers Karen Bass and John Lewis. We spoke with Lewis, who was famously beaten in Selma, Alabama, worked closely with Dr. Martin Luther King, about what Dr. King would think of race issues during the Trump administration.
What do you think Dr. King would think of this particular moment in history?
Dr. King would say, be brave, be courageous, be bold, stand up, and speak out. And help redeem the soul of America.
Congresswoman Karen Bass, what does Congressman John Lewis mean to you, and what has he taught you?
Well, you know, he's such a wonderful mentor, and the way he has led his life, and in Congress, without a doubt, he is the most respected and revered member of the House of Representatives. And when I first came to Congress and I got to call him my colleague, you know, he would get upset with me and tell me to call him John. And I would say, Mr. Lewis, I'm never going to call you John. You're Mr. John Lewis. And, you know, now he's in the fight of his life. And so it was touching to see those pictures of him and to remember him. We're making sure he doesn't come back to the House right now, though. He needs to stay home and get well.
Yeah, and that was such an emotional moment, I think, for both of us at the Community Coalition. That day, I want people to get to know you a little bit, because you were really first inspired to be an activist because of civil rights icons like John Lewis.
Exactly.
Talk to us a little bit about your dad, about your mom, about growing up here, and when you became inspired to do politics.
Absolutely. Well, first of all, I love talking about my parents because I had absolutely amazing parents. And my father turned me into a news junkie at a very young age. I used to sit and watch the news with him throughout his entire life. And I was watching the news coverage of the civil rights protests, and I did not understand it. I mean, it was hard as a child. I was probably 9 or 10 years old watching the news with him. And my father was from Texas, and so he explained to me what life was like in Texas, and I watched Martin Luther King, and I watched John Lewis, and I saw all of that. And I was in such a hurry to grow up because I wanted to be just like them. That's what I wanted to do, because I believed in our country. I believe in our country could be better. And I saw the changes that they made, and I wanted to participate like that. And so I essentially, at a very young age, made a commitment that I was going to devote my life to fighting for social and economic justice. And I feel real good that that is how I've spent my time in life. I never thought about being elected official and certainly never thought about coming to Congress. So my life just evolved, and here I am.
And one of the most profound things you did, we were just showing some pictures of the Community Coalition. This is something that you founded in South L.A. after being a physician's assistant and seeing how bad the crack cocaine epidemic had impacted the African-American community. You said, let's do something about it. Talk to us about that process.
Well, absolutely. And, you know, I always was an activist, whether I was working in the hospital during the day are teaching, because I was, when I started Community Coalition, I was actually on the faculty at USC Medical School. But after work was when I was active on various issues. It just never occurred to me that anybody would pay me to be politically active, so I always had to have something else I was doing. And so when crack cocaine hit, I just felt it was devastating. And what drove me crazy was it was a health issue. And I saw us criminalize a health issue. I saw all the laws being passed, and it was obvious that we were going to have mass incarceration. And the interesting thing, if you think about the debate that's going on now in terms of funding for police versus funding for services, we were fighting at the time to expand services, and we watched them be cut back and cut back and cut back, and more money go into policing and building prisons. And so I walked away from my job. I started Community Coalition. I had no idea what I was doing at the time, but I just believed that there was ways to address crime that didn't involve locking everybody up, especially crime that at its root was related to substance abuse. So I formed Community Coalition, very proud to say that it's 30 years old now. And one of the things that we did was we recruited young people. We recruited high school students, because my life, I started as a middle school and a high school student as an activist. There were always adults around me that helped train me as an activist. And so I wanted to do that to the next generation. Now, prior to COCO and prior to the crack epidemic, I was actually always focused on foreign policy. So I was running an organization at the time as a volunteer called the Southern Africa Support Committee, because we were fighting to end apartheid in South Africa and to free Nelson Mandela. And at a certain point in my life, I was like, I'm fighting to free Nelson Mandela and South Central Los Angeles is falling apart. And that conflict, that contradiction led me to say, I have to figure out what I can do around this problem. And interestingly, the issues I started working on in 1990 are the very issues I'm working on right now in the halls of Congress.
Well, and your first elected office was the Assembly, and then you became the leader of the Assembly in California, the first black woman to ever be the leader of the Assembly in California, the first black woman to ever lead an assembly anywhere in the country. And you were there during the worst economic period since the Great Depression. And now we're heading towards something similar. You were there with Governor Schwarzenegger. You had to deal with all of this. What is your advice to the folks in Sacramento right now on what to do, how to get our country or our state through this moment of crisis?
Oh, you know what? I'm so proud of the state legislature. I don't need to tell them a thing. They know exactly what to do. And, you know, one of the problems that we had that has now been solved were the way we were structured. So, for example, we needed a supermajority to pass a budget. Well, that changed. They only need a majority now. We needed a supermajority to raise taxes. Well, they actually have a supermajority in the state legislature now. So I know we're going to go through some tough times, but I also know that our brilliant leaders in Sacramento have the tools to address the crisis that we didn't have in the last Great Recession.
Well, it is going to be quite a challenge, I think, for everybody from a state, local, and federal perspective in the coming months. Up next, more of your questions as our Fox 11 Town Hall, A Changing America, continues.
You're watching A Changing America, a Fox 11 Town Hall with your host, Elex Michaelson.
So you've been sending in your questions. This was a question from Brendan. The protections that our first responders have are due to the negotiations of their unions. As a proponent of removing protections from them, would you also support removing similar protections negotiated by the teachers' union. My guess is that they're referring to the police union in that question. What do you say to that?
Well, I'm not sure what they're referring to. You know, in the what we're doing is addressing qualified immunity, and that's something, of course, that the unions are opposed to. So I could not say that I would do that with teachers' union. I think that is total apples and oranges. So the problem in policing, though, and, you know, remember when we watched George Floyd be murdered, that police officer was looking dead into the camera. He didn't care. He was looking in the camera and he had his hand in his pocket as he slowly killed George Floyd because he was acting with complete impunity. And so that is one of the basic problems in policing and one of the key parts of our bill. Now, I will say without hands down, it's the most controversial part of our bill. But to me, that applies to policing. I think that might be what the person is referring to in the teachers union. And I don't see the relationship at all.
All right, now let's go to a question, which is a big question a lot of people have today about protests and beaches. Why is it okay, this is from Lisa, okay to protest outside and it won't have an effect on the illness, but they're closing the beaches. What's the difference? Now, as a member of Congress, you're not the person who made the call to close the beaches, but members of your party, right, people that you have supported, are making that call. Is that a good idea for July 4th, keep everybody off the beach?
Well, yes, I think it is a good idea. And I'm sure that when that decision was made because July 4th, a very social holiday where people are going to be drinking, lots and lots of people would go to the beach, and how you're going to maintain social distancing, I think would be very difficult. Now, people were worried about the protesters as well. But, you know, it was interesting because I saw a lot of the protests where, number one, the protesters wore masks. Lots of them, and in some cases, I saw the majority. And you also saw them socially distancing, which I thought was interesting. It made
but
it
were,
look
there were a
very
lot
interesting.
Of, there were a lot of protesters that were not social distancing, and we've seen at the beaches in recent
yes,
weeks, a lot of people are social distancing at the beach, and they are also outside. So you understand why there's
yes.
some frustration on that issue.
Oh, I absolutely do. Listen, I would like to go to the beach, too. I ride my bike on the beach all the time.
Yeah.
But I'm just guessing that that's what went into that decision, especially because it's a holiday. There would be an awful lot of people, and the socializing and drinking that goes on, I think it's different than when you would just regularly be on the beach.
Now to a question from viewer Terry.
I'm worried about the protesters, too.
Yeah. Viewer Terry Eisman, a former intern of ours, who has this question about racial equality and education.
Good evening, Congresswoman. Terry Eisman here, student at UCLA. What are the biggest falsehoods politicians and educational advocates tell themselves that in turn inhibit them from moving the needle forward on racial equity in education? And how will you tackle that?
And hopefully try to keep your answer short.
Well, it needs to be tackled through very serious, specific funding and programming. That's what needs to happen. And there needs to be a commitment to sustain it.
All right. We'll be right back to wrap things up. Some last words from Congresswoman Bass after this. I hope you've all enjoyed the opportunity to get to know Congresswoman Bass a little better. We hope to do this with other members of Congress as well. Last word, maybe 30 seconds, final thoughts on this moment in history.
Well, it's an incredible moment of history. I'm extremely inspired. I hope people stay on the streets until we get the George Floyd Justice and Policing Act on the president's desk. And
but,
thank you for the opportunity.
But do so socially distant with masks, right?
Always, until we get past this moment.
Yeah, or virtual protests as well. And do you think we're going to get
yes,
it passed? I mean,
it.
Is it going to get passed? And when are we looking at for that actually to happen?
Well, the bottom line to me is that we better pass it before the end of July, because then we go on August recess. And then after that, it's all about the election. So I think we have a short window.
All right, Congresswoman.
And I'm hopeful.
Well, thank you so much for the time. We end with music. You pick this song, Get Up, Stand Up, by the late, great Bob Marley. Our message is get educated
right.
and vote, regardless of who you vote for. And,
that's
of course,
right.
we hope to showcase a lot of ideological perspectives here on the show. Congresswoman, thanks again. Appreciate it.
Thanks for having me on.
All right. And thanks to all of you for watching. Have a great night. Stand up for your rights.